Well, today we're going to start a study in the book of Romans, and this will be lesson one. And if I'm not mistaken, I probably got about 50 things I'd like to cover in the book of Romans. And besides that, we're going to go through some of the scripture here too in the study. We're going to take a look at chapter 1, which is kind of an interesting chapter. I'm going to read it and we'll talk a little bit about it. But chapter 1 really brings out that the wrath of God will be poured out on all ungodliness. So it starts out kind of on a sour note, but at the same time it talks about the love of God, talks about salvation. I've always looked at the book of Romans as kind of the fifth gospel. And really, it has got a good message. And the word gospel really means good news. And I believe that Romans is a book that has a lot of good news in it. And I know that one verse that really sticks out in my mind is when Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, and it's the power of God unto salvation, and it truly is. And with that said, let's look at a summary, first of all, of the book of Romans. It brings out some key verses, and then from there, we'll cover more of Romans. So with that said, we'll start our first lesson by just doing a summary. Well, before we start our study in Romans, let's maybe just do a summary of the book. And let's just play this audio.
The book of Romans. The author. Chapter 1, verse 1 identifies the author of the book of Romans as the Apostle Paul. Chapter 16, verse 22 indicates that Paul used a man named Tertius to transcribe his words. The date of writing. The book of Romans was likely written in AD 56-58. The purpose of writing. As with all Paul's epistles to the churches, his purpose in writing was to proclaim the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ by teaching doctrine, and edify and encourage the believers who would receive his letter. Of particular concern to Paul were those to whom his letter was written, those in Rome who were loved by God and called to be saints, chapter 1, verse 7. Because he himself was a Roman citizen, he had a unique passion for those in the assembly of believers in Rome. Since he had not, to this point, visited the church in Rome, this letter also served as his introduction to them. Key verses, chapter 1, verse 16. I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. Chapter 3, verses 9 through 11. What shall we conclude then? Are we any better? Not at all. We have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. Chapter 3, verse 21. But now a righteousness from God apart from the law has been made known, to which the law and prophets testify. Chapter 3, verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Chapter 5, verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Chapter 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Chapter 8, verse 9. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. Chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Chapter 8, verses 37 through 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor any else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. That if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and be saved. Chapter 12, verse 1. Therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Chapter 12, verse 19. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, It is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. Chapter 16, verse 17. I urge you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teaching you have learned. Keep away from them. A brief summary. Paul was excited about being able to minister at last in this church, and everyone was well aware of that fact. Chapter 1, verses 8 through 15. The letter to the Romans was written from Corinth just prior to Paul's trip to Jerusalem to deliver the alms that had been given for the poor there. He had intended to go to Rome and then on to Spain, chapter 15, verse 24, but his plans were interrupted when he was arrested in Jerusalem. He would eventually go to Rome as a prisoner. Phoebe, who was a member of the church at Cenchrea near Corinth, chapter 16, verse 1, most likely carried the letter to Rome. The book of Romans is primarily a work of doctrine and can be divided into four sections: righteousness needed, chapter 1, verse 18 through chapter 3, verse 20, righteousness provided, chapter 3, verse 21 through chapter 8, verse 39, righteousness vindicated, chapter 9, verse 1 through chapter 11, verse 36, and righteousness practiced, chapters 12 through 15. The main theme of this letter is obvious, of course, righteousness. Guided by the Holy Spirit, Paul first condemns all men of their sinfulness. He expresses his desire to preach the truth of God's word to those in Rome. It was his hope to have assurance that they were staying on the right path. He strongly points out that he is not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power by which everyone is saved. The book of Romans tells us about God, who he is, and what he has done. It tells us of Jesus Christ, what his death accomplished. It tells us about ourselves, what we were like without Christ, and who we are after trusting Christ. Paul points out that God did not demand men have their lives straightened out before coming to Christ. While we were still sinners, Christ died on a cross for our sins. Connections. Paul uses several Old Testament people and events as illustrations of the glorious truths in the book of Romans. Abraham believed, and righteousness was imputed to him by his faith, not by his works. Chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. In chapter 4, verses 6 through 9, Paul refers to David, who reiterated the same truth. Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will never count against him. Paul uses Adam to explain to the Romans the doctrine of inherited sin, and he uses the story of Sarah and Isaac, the child of promise, to illustrate the principle of Christians being the children of the promise of the divine grace of God through Christ. In chapters 9 through 11, Paul recounts the history of the nation of Israel and declares that God has not completely and finally rejected Israel, chapter 11, verses 11 and 12, but he has allowed them to stumble only until the full number of the Gentiles will be brought to salvation. Practical application. The book of Romans makes it clear that there is nothing that we can do to save ourselves. Every good deed we have ever done is as a filthy rag before God. So dead in our trespasses and sins are we, that only the grace and mercy of God can save us. God expressed that mercy and grace by sending his Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross in our place. When we turn our lives over to Christ, we are no longer controlled by our sin nature, but we are controlled by the Spirit. If we make confession that Jesus is Lord and believe that he is raised from the dead, we are saved, born again. We need to live our lives offered to God as a living sacrifice to him. Worship of the God who saved us should be our highest desire. Perhaps the best application of Romans would be to apply chapter 1, verse 16, and not be ashamed of the gospel. Instead, let us be faithful in proclaiming it.
God Questions Ministry seeks to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ by providing biblical answers to today's questions.
Well, this morning I decided I'd like to go through the book of Romans, and I'm going to start with chapter 1, and I'm in the English Standard Version. And with that said, let's start our reading with chapter 1.
Paul to the Romans. Chapter 1. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship, to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my Spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow by God's will I may now at last succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you, that is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that I have often intended to come to you, but thus far I have been prevented, in order that I may reap some harvest among you as well as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason God gave them up to dishonorable passions. For their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind, to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them.
Okay, we'll stop our reading. That's chapter 1. And let's just have a word of prayer. Lord, as we look at this chapter in the book of Romans, Lord, I just ask that you reveal things to us, and may we just glean some wonderful things from your word. And Lord, I know that there's a lot of hard things in this chapter. There's a lot of men and women that practice all these things that are spoken of in this chapter. And we know that you love the sinner, but you hate the sin, Lord. And I just pray that as I go through this chapter, that those out there that feel offended, that they would realize that you love them, and that you want them to be one of your children, and want them to obey your word, Lord. And with this said, Lord, we know that you hate all these sins, though. We just pray this now and ask for your blessings. In your name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, we're going to look at this chapter, but I'm going to pause for a minute here, and we'll start from the beginning.
What does it mean to not be ashamed of the gospel? In Romans chapter 1, Paul addresses the Gentile believers at Rome and begins by explaining his mission, which was to preach the gospel to everyone. He concludes his explanation by saying, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith, from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith." Romans 1, verses 16 and 17. The word translated ashamed means disgraced or personally humiliated. A person ashamed in this way is like someone singled out for misplacing his confidence. He trusted in something, and that something let him down. The word can refer to being dishonored because of forming the wrong alliances. So when Paul says that he is not ashamed of the gospel, he is saying his confidence in the gospel is not misplaced. There is no disgrace in declaring it. Paul had given his life to proclaiming the truths that Jesus himself had revealed to him. He explained to the Romans why he did not believe that he had wrongly identified with Jesus, and why proclaiming Jesus' message was his life's work. The application can extend to us as well. Just as Paul placed his confidence in the gospel of Christ, so can we. We can proclaim with boldness the truths that God has revealed in his word, with no fear that our confidence is misplaced. Anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. Romans 10, verse 11. We can rest in the knowledge that the Holy Spirit who inspired the writing of Scripture never changes. What was true thousands of years ago is still true. The offer of salvation that was presented to people of the first century is still open to us. To live unashamed of the gospel means we proclaim it, but it also means we apply it to our lives and show we believe it. Paul's life choices supported his message. He did not preach one thing and live another. We are ashamed of the gospel when we allow sin in our lives to go unchecked, when we indulge in worldliness and carnal desires, or blatantly disobey scriptural standards. We indicate that we lack confidence in our own message. When we walk in the counsel of the ungodly, stand in the path of sinners, and sit in the seat of scoffers, Psalm 1 verse 1, we are being ashamed of the gospel. We are not allowing its truth to penetrate our lives so that others see its changing power. To live unashamed of the gospel means that we, like Paul, allow it to dominate our lives to the extent that everyone within our sphere of influence can see that we have been with Jesus. Acts 4, verse 13.
Question: what does "from faith to faith" mean in Romans chapter 1, verse 17? Our answer: from faith to faith is an expression found in some versions of Romans chapter 1 verse 17, such as the King James Version, the New American Standard Bible, and the Christian Standard Bible. The English Standard Version uses the wording "from faith for faith" instead. The meaning of the phrase becomes more evident in the New International Version. By faith from first to last. And perhaps the most transparent rendering of the verse for today's reader is found in the New Living Translation. From start to finish by faith. To fully understand what "from faith to faith" means, we must consider the phrase in context. In the first chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans, the apostle introduces himself to the church in Rome. While many of the believers there would have heard of Paul, they had not yet met him personally. In preparation for a future visit, Paul wants the members of the church to know him sufficiently to discern fact from fiction concerning his identity. In Romans chapter 1 verses 16 to 17, Paul reaches the high point of his introductory greeting to the church in Rome, "For I am not ashamed of this good news about Christ." It is the power of God at work, saving everyone who believes, the Jew first and also the Gentile. This good news tells us how God makes us right in His sight. This is accomplished from start to finish by faith. As the scriptures say, it is through faith that a righteous person has life, NLT. Nothing mattered more to Paul than fulfilling God's will for his life, which was to preach the good news of salvation. Without the good news of the gospel, and without the power that is the gospel, there can be no salvation, no freedom from sin, no redemption, and no life. The power of the gospel is the theme of Paul's letter to the Romans and the ambition of his life. Paul writes with full knowledge that the church in Rome is facing persecution and suffering under Roman oppression. Many of the believers there are experiencing humiliation and shame because of their faith in Christ. Paul wants them to be assured that the worldly power of Rome cannot hold a candle to the mighty power of God, the gospel of Jesus Christ. That gospel is God's limitless power directed toward the salvation of men and women. For every person who believes, whether Jew or Gentile, man or woman, black or white, the gospel effectively becomes the saving power of God. Paul tells the Roman Christians that in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed, Romans chapter 1 verse 17. Righteousness is thus a complete and total work of God. Humans tend to view righteousness as something we can achieve by our own merit or actions. But the righteousness of God is different. It is a right standing before God that has nothing to do with human accomplishment or worth. It is received by faith. There is nothing we can do to deserve or earn it. The exact meaning of Paul's phrase "from faith to faith" has been debated, with several plausible explanations proposed. Some understand it in relation to the origin of faith, from the faith of God, who makes the offer of salvation, to the faith of men, who receive it. In simpler terms, salvation comes from God's faith, or faithfulness to a faith. This was Karl Barth's impression of the phrase "from faith to faith," that salvation is accomplished through God's faithfulness, which comes first, and our faith in response to that. Others believe that Paul had the spreading of faith through evangelism in mind. From the faith of one believer to another. A third and widely accepted understanding is that "from faith to faith" speaks of a progressive, growing development of faith from one degree of faith to another, akin to the ever-increasing glory of 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. Another view is that Paul meant that from day one of our journey of faith until the very last day we, the righteous, must live by faith. Whether we are brand new followers of Christ or seasoned, mature believers who have walked with the Lord for many years, we must trust God from start to finish and rely on His mighty power, the power of the gospel, to change our lives and the lives of those we encounter. Question: why did Paul say the gospel brings salvation to the Jew first and then the Gentile? Answer: in Romans chapter 1 verse 16, Paul writes, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile." The gospel is intended for all people. But, chronologically, the gospel message was first revealed to the Jewish people before it was revealed to the Gentiles, non-Jewish people. The Jews are God's chosen people, Deuteronomy chapter 7 verses 6 to 7. Through the Jews, God demonstrated His love and holiness to the world. Theirs is the adoption to sonship, theirs the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, Romans chapter 9 verses 4 to 5. It was through the seed of Abraham that all peoples on earth will be blessed, Acts chapter 3 verse 25, cf. Genesis chapter 22 verse 18, 26-4. That promised blessing came through Jesus Christ, as explained in Galatians chapter 3 verse 16. Jesus was born as a Jew under the law, fulfilled the Jewish law perfectly. and died as a once-for-all sacrifice on behalf of all who would put their faith in him. Galatians chapter 4 verses 4 to 5, Hebrews chapter 9 verses 14 to 15, 23 to 28. In his public ministry, Jesus spoke of being sent to the Jews, and he focused his efforts on them. He was the Jewish Messiah, and he had come, in part, to strengthen Judah and save the tribes of Joseph, Zechariah chapter 10 verse 6. On one occasion, Jesus seemed to rebuff the pleas of a Gentile woman, though he later helped her in Matthew chapter 15 verses 21 to 28, also see Matthew chapter 10 verse 5. Jesus predicted that repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in Christ's name to all nations beginning at Jerusalem, Luke chapter 24 verse 47, emphasis added. The gospel of the kingdom was to be a blessing to the whole world, but it was natural that it be first proclaimed to Israel. When Paul speaks of the gospel bringing salvation first to the Jew in Romans chapter 1 verse 16, he alludes to the special relationship the Jews had to the Messiah. The Christ was the son of David, and the hope of the Messiah had long been held by the Jews, see Luke chapter 2 verse 38. So, when the gospel of Christ was first proclaimed, the Jews had priority. We see this prioritization in Paul's first missionary journey. Every time they would come to a new city, Paul and Barnabas would preach in the synagogue to the Jews in that city. In Pisidian Antioch, they were so opposed by the unbelieving Jews that the missionaries said, "We had to speak the word of God to you first. Since you reject it and do not consider yourselves worthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles," Acts chapter 13 verse 46. The persecution in Antioch continued, and Paul and Barnabas were eventually expelled, so they went to the next town, verse 51. There are several important things to note about Paul's statement that the power of God in the gospel brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. First, God did not cease saving Jews in order to save Gentiles. In all of his missionary journeys, Paul continued to preach first in the synagogues. God continues to desire the salvation of all the world, John chapter 3 verses 16 to 18, 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 4. Second, Jews are neither better nor worse than Gentiles. All need the Savior, and, in Christ, all are on equal spiritual footing. Colossians chapter 3 verses 10 to 11 reminds us we have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its Creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. The believing Gentile is just as welcome in the family of God as the believing Jew. The Jew who has faith in Christ Jesus is just as secure in his salvation as the born-again Gentile. Finally, salvation comes the same way to both Jews and Gentiles. It is for everyone who believes, Romans chapter 1 verse 16. Jesus is the only way of salvation, Acts chapter 4 verse 12, John chapter 14 verse 6, regardless of one's heritage. Paul said, "I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus," Acts chapter 20 verse 21. Galatians chapter 3 verses 26 to 28 says, "So in Christ Jesus you are all children of God through faith, for all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. All must come to Jesus in faith for salvation, and all are equally accepted by him when they do."
Well, there's more I'd like to cover in this chapter, but I'd like to try to keep our lessons to about 30 minutes, and we're right at that 30-minute mark coming up. So, and there's also a little bit more that we're going to look at in kind of a form of an introduction to this book, and we'll cover that in our second lesson. And with that said, why don't we just close in a word of prayer. Lord, as we we look at the book of Romans, I just think of all the wonders of your love and grace, and Lord, all the mysteries that you have revealed to us. And in our finite minds, Lord, we can't totally understand everything that is in the Bible, Lord, because you are so far above us. And Lord, but we do try to understand what we can, and may we learn that whatever we read in your word, that we have to apply it to our lives, Lord, and that you want us to live a godly life. And I know that we live in a wicked world full of sin, and Lord, right from the very beginning, from the fall of man, it's been a struggle, and you understand it because you became a man. You came down, you left the glories of heaven and came down to die on a cross. And that's the good news of the gospel, and it's also the good news that's found in the book of Romans too, Lord. And we just praise you now, and till we get together again in the next lesson, Lord, may we just try to understand what we have learned today already. And we pray this in your wonderful name, Lord Jesus. Amen.